Hey, are you a business owner, entrepreneur, or professional? If so, we want you to apply to be a featured guest on our show. My name is Adam Torres, and I host the Mission Matters series of podcasts. I've recorded over 3,000 episodes, and we are just getting started. How do you know if you'd be a good guest to be on the show? Well, only one way to find out, and that's to apply, but I'm going to let you in on a little secret. We want guests that have a story to tell, guests with a brand, a product, or a service that can benefit my audience of listeners. If this sounds like you, go to missionmatters.com and click on Be Our Guest to Apply. I'd love to talk to you and get to know more about your story. Again, head on over to missionmatters.com and click on Be Our Guest to Apply. All right, now let's get into the show.
Hey, I'd like to welcome you to another episode of Mission Matters Business, your source for all things business. My name is Adam Torres, and if you'd like to apply to be a guest on the show, head on over to missionmatters.com and click on Be Our Guest to Apply. All right, so today I have Todd MacLaughlan on the line, and he's CEO over at Profounda and Profounda Health and Beauty. Todd, welcome to the show.
Hey, Adam, thanks so much for having me on your show. Glad to be here.
All right, Todd. So we have a lot to cover today between Profounda and Profounda Health and Beauty. I mean, you are a busy guy and you're solving some big problems, both for both serious problems and also, doing some manufacturing, which we'll talk about also. So maybe just to get us kicked off, just tell us a little bit more about how you got started on this path. I mean, like how'd you get these businesses going?
Yeah, so I've had a long background working in the pharmaceutical industry. I was at Bayer Corporation. I was at Allergan. I was at Watson, which is a generic company. I head up contract manufacturing for Cardinal Health, and later becomes Catalent. I head up drug delivery business for SEMA Labs, which is part of Cephalon. So I have a lot of different types of experience, both in sales, marketing, manufacturing, international marketing. It sort of logically came as my hair kept on getting lighter and lighter that I should look to do some other things. And about 7 years ago, I came across an opportunity to develop a first to file product, actually a microsphere product that we're hoping to put out this year. Most people go to their dentist. They bring along their bad brushing habits, and they end up with the dentist saying, you should brush more here, brush more there.
Yeah.
They're quoting numbers 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So typically, if you have a number of 4, 5 or more, you have something called periodontal disease. Mm-hmm. And they do something called deep cleaning. And they do about 6 million procedures a year. And it's just as painful as it sounds. It's usually done under local anesthesia. But they usually apply a drug that's in a microsphere form right after they do that cleaning to allow the gum to grow back without being reinfected again. Mm-hmm. The brand name for that drug is called Arestin. We should have the first generic for that drug anywhere in the world. Mm. Now, microsphere products in general, there's probably about 8 microsphere products in the world. Mm. They generate over $20 billion in revenue a year. And we will be the first ever to launch a generic drug. So you can imagine if we're successful in this venture for that particular product, we'll be expanding into other microsphere products as well.
Wow, that's a big deal. And I know exactly what you're talking about, because every time I go to the dentist, when they put that little, I don't know what it's called, and then they count and she's doing the number, she's like 1, 2, 3.
Charting,
four.
Yeah.
Yeah, charting. There you go. I'm like, oh, please no fives, please no fives.
Yeah, and usually in the back or something. But the drug itself does about $150 million a year. Mm. So it's one of the smaller microfiber products that are out there, but it is one that we think that we can be first to market on. So there's a lot of things we had to learn about how to make microspheres. We had to learn also about the little syringe that goes with that microsphere, the little tips that go with that microsphere. So there's a medical device component to it as well. We met with the FDA a couple of times, and we think we know how to do it. And we're a small company. There's only about 15 people here, but we're trying to swing for the fences and make some big things happen. And I'm looking forward to telling you about other things we're doing as well that we've already done.
So I understand there's two different companies, so Profounda and Profounda Health and Beauty. So maybe first just tell us a little bit more about the distinction and the focuses.
Yeah, so the main purpose of Profounda is to develop that drug we just mentioned. And that's why the company was formed. And we didn't know when we formed the company that I would start thinking about other things to do as well.
Yeah.
And so along the way, we have our licenses, we have our equipment to do what we need to do there. We in-licensed a product for infectious disease, a product called Impavido. And Impavido is used for treatment of free living amoeba infections. We'll get into that a little bit later on. And then we also in-licensed some allergy products, some dry nose products. Mm-hmm. And then we started developing our own dry nose products and allergy products. And then we went into making cosmetic products for other companies. And then we said, well, if we can make it for them, we can make it for us. So we started making our own line of cosmetics as well. So we're in all kinds of spaces for 15 people. So whether you're talking, which is helpful, actually, especially if you're going through COVID, you know, some of the international travel is down.
Yeah.
And our main drug is used for something called Leishmaniasis, which is endemic in 88 countries, kills lots of people around the world, but people in the United States usually get it from traveling. Well, they really haven't traveled a lot lately. So that part of the business is down for that indication, but mm-hmm. it's up in other indications. And certainly, you know, allergies and cold and flus, that's certainly up these days. So mm-hmm. all in all, we're doing okay. We're having a fun time. And you really get, when you're in a smaller company, you really get to touch the customer. They ask for me sometimes, and we get to know them. And so you don't make as many big things happen, but you can make things happen that are pretty special.
That's awesome. I'd like to spend some time and let's go through some of the products specifically that you're working on, their purposes, and also some of the problems they're solving. Maybe let's start with the free living amoeba and just maybe an overview on just what that overall problem looks like that you're looking to solve.
Right. So what is a free living amoeba? Probably the first question that you have in mind. It's not amoeba walking around saying, hey, I'm free. It's basically, but it is, most parasites actually have to live in a host. Mm-hmm. So free living amoebas do not have to live in a host. So that's the one of the main differences with them. So they hang around in the environment quite a lot longer. Mm-hmm. So Naegleria fowleri, for example, is something that you may have heard of. It's associated with a disease called the brain eating amoeba, mm-hmm. or PAM is another name for it. Basically, people who swim in fresh water, they jump in, they get water up their nose, the amoeba goes up the nose, and there's a nerve that goes between your nose and your brain that the amoeba says, hey, nice highway, let me go up there. And if it goes up there, you have a 97% chance of dying. So it's a pretty serious side effect. The symptoms are typically headache. Initial symptoms are headache, typically sensitive to light, sensitive mm-hmm. to touch, a stiff neck. Now, those symptoms, you know, if you had children, you probably heard those symptoms of your child many times, and it's hard to differentially diagnose. Mm-hmm. The other two main causes are bacterial meningitis and viral meningitis. Mm-hmm. And typically, the doctors worry about bacterial meningitis because it's more common. Mm-hmm. There's 1.2 million cases in the world and about 200,000 cases in the United States of bacterial meningitis. And the symptoms are identical to viral meningitis. So a lot of times, unfortunately, people misdiagnose what they're dealing with. And by the time they realize it, the patient is dead or is on the way to dying. So what we're trying to do as part of our efforts is to increase the awareness overall that, hey, if you hear that someone's been in water, and typically, unfortunately, it's a child that tends to do the swimming off the decks and get the water off the nose. That if you hear that, then automatically think of amoeba as being a possibility. So as rare it is, and people have a lot of misconceptions, they think that, well, this is a Florida disease or this is a South American disease. This really doesn't happen up in Michigan, does mm-hmm. it? It does. It can come from, well, first of all, people travel. So people can travel to Florida on vacation, come back to Michigan. So the doctor who sees that patient may see them in Michigan, not necessarily in Florida. So they have to be aware of it. So that's the first thing. The second thing is we're trying to make sure through our education that we have the product available. So in some cases, you have, even in bacterial meningitis, you have many hours or many days to solve the problem. You really don't have that much time to solve the problem. Someone asked me, you know, how long can you live with a brain-eating infection? My question is, well, it depends how smart you want to be when you come out the other side, because your brain is being eaten by the amoeba. And so we stock right now 26 hospitals for free. We actually send the product there for free. The logic is we could have it at our warehouses and just sitting there and then having to ship it to them. But by the time it takes to ship, as fast as we do, we ship overnight, next day air, we use custom critical. It's still going to take 6, 8, 10, 12 hours to get to from one part of the country to the other. Now, by having these 26 countries across the country that have the product in stock, they can start treatment within hours, if not minutes. So we have used it many times. We have transferred it from one hospital to the other hospital. We've had the police involved. There's a story in Colorado where they brought it from one hospital in a nearby state, north of South Dakota, I can't remember, by a police car to a police helicopter to other police cars just to get it there in time.
Wow.
And you go, well, that's great. But at the same time, the other hospital could have just asked for the product to be free at their hospital. right? So, and it's all because it's so rare, they just think, well, it'll never happen to me, so therefore I don't need it. It's like your airbag. How often have you used your airbag in your car? Never, for most people. Mm-hmm. But when you're in an accident, you want that airbag to be there, and the same thing goes with this drug. So that's that's the first part of the free living amoeba. The drug itself, Impavida, was approved for something called Leishmaniasis. Mm-hmm. And Leishmaniasis is the second largest killer of people in the world, believe it or not. And probably never heard of it before.
I have not.
And it's endemic in 88 countries around the world. It's a female sandfly that bites you. It goes through a cycle with a dog. And so it goes from the sandfly to the dog to the human and back again. And when the patient gets it, there's three different forms they can get. There's what's called a cutaneous form. And that cutaneous form is like a mosquito bite. You see something on your skin, mm-hmm. But then it doesn't go away and then it keeps on growing. So it looks like I call it a little mini volcano, mm-hmm. And just keeps on growing. And usually doesn't heal on its own for 8 to 10 months, and very disfiguring. If I showed you some pictures later on, you would not want to have lunch right away.
Yeah.
It's pretty gross pictures. But the other part is visceral Leishmaniasis. And visceral means it's inside your organs. So it's attacking your liver, attacking your lungs, it's attacking your kidneys. Mm. And when that happens, that's why you die. So 60,000 people roughly die a year of Leishmaniasis around the world. So again, a lot. The other condition is called mucosal Leishmaniasis, where it basically goes into your throat. Only certain strains do it, but when it goes into your throat, it starts dissolving your throat structure. So you can imagine your tongue being eaten away, your cheeks being eaten away, your larynx being eaten away.
Yeah.
It's a very deadly disease. Now, if I haven't scared you enough yet.
I'm scared.
let me tell you that I can also hibernate, and your white blood cells, which normally protects you against other diseases, actually lives inside the white blood cell.
Wow.
And can pop out 5 years later. So you can go down to Costa Rica on your vacation, your honeymoon. We actually had a honeymoon couple that went down there. Mm-hmm. You could come back three years later and all of a sudden have something that you picked up in Costa Rica 3 years earlier.
Whoa.
So it's scary. That's the best way to put it. So, and then the last, so I just told you about two scary things. The other one is just as scary, but it affects more people in the United States in particular. And that is something called Acanthamoeba Keratitis. So it's a free living form of the amoeba that lives in the eye. And typically 90% of cases are associated with people who wear contact lenses. I apologize if I talk too much, but I'll talk about this forever. But people who wear contact lenses, they'll be exposed to fresh water where the amoeba lives. They'll have a scratched cornea, or they'll leave their contact lenses on for just a little bit too long, or they'll rinse them underneath the kitchen tap. When they do that, then basically the amoeba finds a home in the eye and just starts eating away the eye. Mm. And at first, if you talk to the typical patient with Acanthamoeba Keratitis, they go to their doctor, they say, something's wrong with my eye, it's very sensitive to light, it's a little bit painful. He'll say, you must have a scratched cornea, we'll give you some steroids. Well, unfortunately, steroids is the wrong thing to do for Acanthamoeba Keratitis because it can actually force it into this, to the what's called the cyst state. Mm. So the amoeba lives in three different forms. The two major forms are the eating form of the trophocyte and then the cyst form, which is like storage, I guess. Mm. Think of like a seed.
Yeah.
And when you turn it into the seed, then your chemicals don't work anymore. And then that seed penetrates deeper and deeper and deeper into that cornea to the point where the topical drops no longer work. And so up until maybe 10 years ago, the only cure for Acanthamoeba was to take your eye out.
Oh.
The only cure. So now, in the last 18 months or so, we've treated off-label. So it's not actually an approved indication. It is an orphan designation. So there are data to support it. And the FDA does have information about treatment of free-living amoeba with, so there is science behind it. We treat about 200 patients now with Acanthamoeba Keratitis.
Wow.
There's really nothing else to treat them. They use two other chemicals primarily. They use Broline and they use PHMB. Basically, they're pool chemicals that they use. They're just trying to kill it. But of course, you can imagine they're toxic to the eye as well. So you have this balance. Yeah. And when I say drops, I don't mean one drop a day. I mean one drop every hour for two or three weeks. It's like waterboarding of the eye. So this is a new tool for corneal specialists and for ophthalmologists. When they see a patient now, it's not like, oh my God, what do I do? At least they now have something, another tool in the toolbox to try. I think the drug is working quite well in that area.
Wow. So what have been,
I apologize.
No. This is great. And I mean, 'cause you're solving some big problems. So, I mean, you're saving eyes, you're saving lives, you're improving the quality of life and you're tackling some big problems out here. What has been some of the responses from some of these things that you're treating just overall? I mean, 'cause Profounda is doing some amazing things.
Yeah, thank you. I mean, obviously, we get to talk to the physicians and to the patients. So, you know, I'll give you an example. There was one patient in Southern Florida that lost her eyesight as a child in one eye. She was actually a lab technician. She had acanthamoeba in the other eye, and basically she was going to lose that eye. So here was a person who was not only going to lose her eye, but also lose her livelihood because she couldn't do that anymore. These things always happen on a Friday night or a Saturday morning, always. They never happen during the week in the middle of the day. So we actually drove the drug directly to the pharmacy in Southern Florida from our location here in Orlando. And that patient now sees 20/25 or better. So that patient has her eye and she's doing well. So she changed her life. And when I talk about our other products too, they're considered cosmetics or over-the-counter products. It sounds like they're not that big a deal, but they actually do affect people's lives. And I think that's probably one thing that does differentiate Profounda is the things that we do make, that does make life better for patients who take our products. And we make them in a quality environment. A lot of products that we make for over-the-counter or cosmetic basis, they don't have to be made in the clean room, for example. They don't have to be made with the same GMP standards you use for a drug. We do. So our standards are quite high for our products. So that's one of the things that we do. You know, take care of the customer, do the right thing. And if you do that, then hopefully business will be good.
Yeah, I can see it. And just thinking about, you know, so especially and the education piece of what you're talking about, especially like talking about kids jumping in, you know, in a lake and what that looks like. How important is the education piece to what you're doing? Because it seems like they go hand in hand to me.
It is important, but again, you have to combine that with rare. So when you talk to a infectious disease specialist or emergency room physician, he may have never seen a case of that in his entire career.
For sure.
So I can teach you about which is the best drug to treat that, but by the time you see it, you probably forgot what I told you. So a couple of things. I mean, we work with the families whose kids have died. Yeah. For example, the Smelsky Foundation, the Kyle Cares Foundation. Both of those, unfortunately, lost their son. In the case of the case here in Florida, the same doctor saw the kid that he was able to save in a year earlier, the one that he was unable to save. So we actually were lucky enough to do that. So we by having the product available at multiple sites, at least we now know that. My personal cell phone number is on the CDC website. So the CDC will call me or the doctor will call me, asking me how to get the drug. We'll do a coordination with however fast we can get to the drug, that's what we're going to do. I put employees on planes. We don't charge for that. We just say, what's the fastest way to get to the drug to give you the best chance for the good outcome? By working with the foundations that have children lost, we make sure that you know they take a big part of that education component too as well. But again, and so some of them do it differently. Some do it, but education physicians and educating lab technicians. In fact, it's very important that lab technicians in hospitals really know how to look. The case in Florida, Sheila Black was the lab technician. Just happened to know that name. She took the course the year before, found out when she did her first look at the slide, didn't see anything, looked at the chart, realized it was a child that actually was a lifeguard at a park in Southern Florida. Yeah. Said, you know what, I better take another look. And she took that extra look that maybe took an extra minute and a half, 2 minutes. And sure enough, she found the amoeba. And because she did that, without question, that boy is alive, without question. So education does work. There's proof for it right there. We just need to make sure it's there. And on our website and on the Smelsky website and other websites, we do have very easy tools. So if I get a call, I got a call a couple of days ago, we'll send them information. Here's all the drugs you should use. Here's all the data that we know about it, because they're learning on the spot. And so we're trying to give them a concentrated piece of information as quickly as possible to give them the best chance to help that patient. A lot of times we're seeing patients that are coming from another hospital. So they go to another hospital. In case of Jordan, the one that died, he got sent home saying, oh, it's probably just viral meningitis, go home. If you're still sick tomorrow, come back. Well, he came back tomorrow, but he didn't make it. In other cases, they're at a regional hospital and the regional hospital doesn't realize what they're dealing with yet. So they wait. And if they just wait too long, then the hospital that does have the drug may not have the time to do what they need to do. So it's pretty interesting.
Yeah. So you're solving some big problems. I want to go further into some of the other things that you're doing. So I know you have the allergy product side of things. Tell us a little bit more about that.
Yeah, so we have a line of product. We have two lines, actually. One product is called Rhinase, and Rhinase comes in both a gel formulation and a spray formulation. Allergy is the sixth most common reason why you see your physician. You know, I have a cold, I have a flu. Yeah. You go see your doctor for that reason. A lot of people think that, you know, if I say to you, you have a runny nose and you're sneezing, do you have allergies? Your normal answer would be yes. But in fact, you may have a dry nose. And if you think about how the nose is made, a normal, healthy, functioning nose has a thin layer of mucus. It has these little tiny hairs called cilia, and they sort of move this layer of fluid in your nose so that every time pollen lands in your nose, it hits this river of mucosa, if you will, and it goes back down your throat and you swallow it. So then you don't have any allergies as a result. Yeah. You get allergies only when the pollen actually hits the surface of your nose that's unprotected. So when you have a dry nose, that's exactly what you're talking about. You're talking about a nose that's unprotected. So the symptoms of dry nose are still runny nose, which is kind of, well, how can you have a runny nose when you have a dry nose? That doesn't make sense. It's your body's way of trying to rehydrate the nose with more mucus because it knows that it's dry. So it's trying to do that. Sneezing, itchiness, congestion, those are all signs of dry nose. So many people who are taking drugs today, and so if you look at what do people take for allergies, on one hand, they may use a saline rinse. A saline rinse is there to flush out the pollen, et cetera. And it does work for a little while.
Yeah.
But it's not moisturizing, and it's not really doing anything to help you moisturize or to actually treat the allergy. It's just sort of getting rid of the pollen. On the other end of the spectrum, you have drugs that you may use, Flonase being the most common one that most people are familiar with. Nasacort would be the other one.
Yeah.
And these are steroids. So steroids themselves are anti-inflammatory, and I'm from the drug industry. Drugs are good. I don't have any problem with drugs being from the drug industry. However, you have to ask yourself, if you compare using Rhinase for 4 weeks and using Flonase or Nasacort for 4 weeks, and there's no difference at the end because you basically have cured the dryness, which basically stopped the itchiness, stopped the congestion, et cetera. Do you really need to use a drug? Because a drug does have side effects. That's why they're called drugs. They're safe and effective, but with the safety comes side effects. So the side effect of a steroid, for example, is adrenal suppression for children. So you have to be very careful. You give a Flonase to a child because it could cause adrenal suppression, which is a negative problem. It causes dryness. Steroid break can cause dryness. They're also more expensive for the people who are cost conscious. They're also more expensive than our product would be. So you can get the same effect that you get with that, but without the cost and without the drug.
Yeah.
A lot of people use your drug, if you look at some of the reviews on Amazon, for example, a lot of people use your drug because they get nosebleeds that are caused by dryness. So if you think you have a very dry mucosa, and you may use Afrin, you may use a steroid. Those can cause nosebleeds. We had stories when we talked about affecting people's lives. You know, I have one story that comes to mind that jumps in every morning. I wake up where a woman called. She said, you know, I used to wake up every morning with my husband, and my husband would have a nosebleed in the middle of the night.
Wow.
So every morning, our routine was to wash the bedroom sheets to get rid of the blood so I can redo it again. And she wrote back and said, you know, it's been 3 weeks now, and there hasn't been a single nosebleed. And so, well, it sounds like it's mild. It's actually
huge.
It's a huge effect on the quality of life.
For sure.
The only other story I'll give you is a kid that was playing soccer, and he used to get bumped in soccer as you do. I don't know. That must have been pre-COVID days when that was happening. But he got bumped, and when he got bumped, his nose would bleed. Well, if you're a coach and you're coaching soccer, and I was a coach for soccer, the kid comes off the field because you don't want him bleeding over other players. So this particular player now who loves to play soccer can't play soccer because of his nosebleed. He got put on Rhinase. He doesn't have nosebleeds. He can get bumped and he can continue to play soccer. So these are small things, but they're important things in terms of the quality of life, whether it's, like you said, saving an eye, saving a life, but also saving a pillowcase. I mean, even that is important. And so we think we make some good products. We also make an all-natural product called Zynase, which is a xylitol. So there's a big movement toward all-natural products. So our product has xylitol in it, salt water, basically. And for the preservative, it uses grapefruit extract. So pretty straight ingredients. You can make it yourself. The thing about xylitol, many dentists and many ENTs believe that xylitol may have some antimicrobial benefits as well. So people who get constant sinus infections and things, they may find that that product will work better. Now, for dryness, I think the Rhinase product is better, but certainly we do have some people that like it. obviously, xylitol is made. It's a natural sweetener, but it's sweet. So when it does run down your throat, it tastes good. So some people like it because it tastes good, to be honest with you. So we have that. And then lastly, outside of allergy, what else do we do? So we sort of forayed into the cosmetic industry. So our first product is, and we took a look around and said, well, what can we do in this industry that's new and innovative and hasn't been done before? So that's sort of the way that we work here. As a small company, we can't go head to head with Revlon per se. So we said, well, so there's a lot of chemical peels that are ongoing. People basically getting the AHAs, the BHAs, they do their peel, then they have to neutralize the peel. Dr. Gross would be an example of that. And then their face goes red and then it peels, and your wife or girlfriend doesn't want you to look at them for a while because their face is not very pretty for a couple of days. We said, you know, there's probably a better way to do this. So what if we sort of came up with a formulation that had AHA and BHA in it and some other things, and you look on our website to see that. But that they could use every day, that they didn't need to neutralize. And they basically, after they wash their face in the morning or wash their face in the evening, they just put a very light coating of this on, go to bed, and then don't worry about it. And then over time, it becomes part of their routine. And then they basically get young, healthy looking skin, fewer wrinkles, all the benefits you get with the chemical peel, but not necessarily with the bad stuff you have to go through. And I'd like to tell you that we're innovative. We're not, when we see a good idea, we're happy to take it from somebody else. And actually, Korea has a product like this. And people in Korea are known very well for their skincare. They have great skincare in Korea. And so we basically looked at this product. Now, it's not the exact product that we saw in Korea, but that concept basically exists in Korea, this daily chemical facial peel. And we think it's a good product. We priced it at $42. So it's right in the middle of where things will go. Right now, it's available only online, but we hope to get into Sephora and other things. It uses all clean ingredients. I'm sure people who listen to your show may understand clean ingredients for cosmetics. It's all that. It's cruelty-free. All the things that you're looking for. Actually, any product from Profounda, you can assure yourself we use the highest quality and the best practices that we can do. So that's how we got into that. And then once we started doing that, now I have manufacturing capability. And so people approached us. And we have at least two companies. I won't mention the name, but one of them, they have a cough syrup that they sell at CVS, for example, and they use Manuka honey in order to do that. So we actually make that product for them. And then we have another company that we make probably 8 products for, and they're all in the cosmetics. So a hand cream, a foot cream, a shaving cream, those kinds of things. So basically, we have a contract manufacturing capability because we brought it in for ourselves, but now we have extra capacity. So I said, well, what can we do with that? And two of my previous jobs was running contract manufacturing facilities. So I know how to make stuff, and I know how to make it in the right way. So we offered this to other companies, and we just started doing this last year. And already, like I said, we have probably 5 customers where we make products for in addition to our own. So we're not your usual...
I see.
Pharma company. we have our fingers in a lot of different areas, and we're just trying to make good quality products that people need and want, and we're excited.
Man, Todd, you have me excited. I'm over here like thinking like I want to make something too. What can I make?
we can make it for you if you come up with the right idea.
And I know that's right idea, I'll tell you about thinking. It. I'm like, man, I want to make something too. Now I know who to go to. I'm like, Todd, I have an idea. You're gonna be like, Adam, what? The interview's over, Adam. No, I have an idea. Hear me out, Todd.
All right, I'll hear you. Well, after this is over, we'll go through your idea.
That's awesome.
But we're not very big. I think I said that before. We have about 8,400 square feet of facility. We, as a company, we have no debt. So we're still going to be around here next year. So we don't owe any money to anybody at this point. Just come back to make contract manufacturing. So we have one room right now that we manufacture. We're expanding that to 2. And then it's really 2 buildings. On the other building, we do secondary packaging. So putting things in the boxes.
So you have a lot going on, Todd. I mean, what's next? Like, let's talk about the distribution. Like, what's next for the products overall? I know you do big business on Amazon. What's next?
Yeah, it depends on what day you ask me that question, because it may be different if I answer it tomorrow. But so we're looking for ways that, so for example, with Impavido, our drug, we know that there's some other benefits to this drug that works against bacteria. So drug-resistant bacteria that might be associated with with the meningitis. And so there's something that we want to look at into a little bit further, maybe do some studies along those lines. Mm-hmm. We're looking at doing studies in India with our Acanthamoeba Keratitis. Mm-hmm. So we're working with the institution there in India to actually, we'll provide the drug. They have the protocol written. We're just in the process of doing that now. For over-the-counter products, I think 2021 is the year of retail for us. So we're going from online to brick and mortar, I guess. We're doing well online. We are expanding online presence as well. So we are on Amazon.com. We are on Walmart.com. We just got onto Kroger.com. You probably won't see it yet because it's not physically in the system yet, but but we have the permission to go forward with that. And then we sell through our own website as well. So we have a an online presence. So and true to everything else we do not charge our customers for shipping. So whether you buy it in the store or buy it online, you don't have to worry about it. We ship it to you at no charge. So we absorb that as part of our business model. We don't think people should have to worry about, well, you're making money on shipping. That's what you're really doing. Nope. We want you to use it. And most of our products are repeat. Sorry, most of our customers are repeat customers.
Wow.
If you think about it. So that's sort of why it makes sense in our model.
And you mentioned brick and mortar. So brick and mortar, tell me a little bit more about that. Like, how's that work?
So brick and mortar. So the first thing to get into brick and mortar, you have to get into a distributor. So we got into our very first distributor this year, about 3 months ago.
Congratulations. It's amazing.
Yeah. It's not as easy as you think. I can tell
you. I know it's not. Shelf space is hard. I get it.
Yeah. So Unify is who we're using for a distributor. And then we signed or we basically did a deal with Whole Foods. So now in over 500 Whole Foods stores for both our Rhinase gel as well as our Zynase products. So, and we know in the first month or so, we've sold over 2,000 units off the shelf. From Whole Foods, so not only into the store but out of the store. So that's good, and we hope to continue doing that. We sample our products through ear, nose, and throat physicians, primarily allergists. So they like our product, which is a good professional endorsement of our product as well. So we're looking to expand. In addition to the Whole Foods stores, Unify has 3,000 other customers. Mm-hmm. So we're in the process this month of trying to get into some of those stores as well. So we hope by the end of the year that we should be in about 2,000 stores with our products. So that's a big thing. We are looking to expand globally. So we are looking, we're doing some activities in Canada, mainly because I'm from Canada, so I understand that marketplace quite well. So we are looking at selling some of our products in Canada as well. And then as I think next year, we'll look for finding global partners for our products to sell our products globally. So so a lot of things on our plate for sure, in addition to the filing for the microsphere with the FDA. So we have a lot of things going, but I have a great team of people that work with me here. Three of my family members do work with me as well. Wow. In this company. So it's really
love
nice.
A family business.
Especially with the COVID environment where it's hard to see family members. We're very close, and it's great to have my kids working with me here. We're doing a lot of things, and it's fun and it's challenging some days. I remember my old boss says you have high highs and low lows, and that's certainly true. Being able to talk to the customers, knowing that patient that would have lost her eye didn't lose her eye. Knowing that person doesn't have that nosebleed every morning. Those are the things that say, yep, we're doing the right things here at Profounda and Profounda Health Beauty.
Man, that's great, Todd. Well, first off, what a great story. I'm really happy to have you on the show to talk about both Profounda and Profounda Health and Beauty and all the great work that you're doing. If somebody is watching this right now or listening to it in their car, what's the best way for people to follow up and to learn more about the brands overall?
Well, you can send me your resumes because we're still growing as a company. So that's the first thing I can tell you. We're based in Orlando, so we're looking at doing that. But the other thing I forgot to tell you, we are also launching a Nature Pro line of products as well. A natural line of products that are immune supportive as well. So we think that there's some opportunity there, as well as some other things that I can't share with you right now. But just be assured that we're looking at other products to develop.
Oh, yeah.
For the drug product, obviously, you have to go through your physician to order the product. There's a lot of things we still didn't talk about. So in addition to the leishmaniasis for humans, there's also leishmaniasis in dogs. It will kill the dog if you don't treat it properly. We've treated about 30 dogs here in the United States as well. So saving eyes, yes. Now I also save dogs. That's one of the things that we add to our list of things. But So the drugs are available through the normal physician channel. Basically, the physician will call me or the pharmacist will call me and they just simply write a prescription. We have a very, the drug, as you can imagine, is an expensive drug because it's such a rare population. That being said, whether you have insurance or don't have insurance or have a high copay, we will make sure that your cost is never more than $100, period.
Wow.
So that's our ability as a small company to do these kinds of things. So we so if the doctor wants to use our drug, he can. Cost should not be a factor. For our other products, like we mentioned, they're available at Whole Foods. And certainly if your audience can buy some at Whole Foods, that would be helpful, especially now as we're in the middle of launch mode. That would make me very appreciative. You can buy directly from us through ryanace.com. You can buy it on walmart.com. You can buy it on amazon.com as well. And then soon some other ones that are coming along. So if you like our company, please support us by buying our products and we'll keep on doing the right things here.
Man, Todd, what a great story. And again, thank you for coming on the show. This has truly been a pleasure to get into the business and what you're doing. And then I love a family business. So that makes it even better for me. I'm like, man, this is a great success story. And congrats again on Whole Foods and the distribution and Kroger. You're doing big things and I'm excited to watch the company grow and to just keep on watching you launch more meaningful products that are helping people and even saving lives. I mean, that's a big deal. And so thank you for that. And to the audience, as always, thank you for tuning in. Hope you got a lot of value out of this. If you did, don't forget, hit that subscribe button. We definitely want you to come back and check out. We have more great guests coming up for you. And Todd, thanks again for coming on the show. It's been great.
Thanks, Adam. Nice talking to you.